too are invited to follow Christ. So as we begin this celebration, let us commit ourselves anew to that enterprise, and also confess to God our failings as Christian disciples. For God opens his heart to those who truly repent. Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
gather them from the far ends of earth, all of them, the blind and the lame, women with child, women in labour, a great company returning home. They had left in tears. I will comfort them as I lead them back. I will guide them to streams of water by a smooth path where they will not stop. For I am a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn son. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Mark.
As Jesus left Jericho with his disciples and a large crowd, Bartimaeus, that is, the son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting at the side of the road. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout and to say, "Son of David, Jesus, have pity on me." And many of them scolded him and told him to keep quiet. But he only shouted all the louder, "Son of David, have pity on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him here." So they called the blind man. "Courage," they said, "get up, he is calling you." So, throwing off his cloak, he jumped up and went to Jesus. Then Jesus spoke, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Rabboni," the blind man said to him, "Master, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has saved you." And immediately his sight returned, and he followed him along the road. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Bartimaeus followed Jesus en te hodo along the road. Not so remarkable, you might think, but the Gospel writer isn't concerned just to relate an episode from the ministry of Jesus. He writes with a purpose. The road is not only the road to Jerusalem, where Jesus will suffer and die. It is also the way of Christian discipleship. The disciples of Jesus have been very slow to recognize what was going on. The appearance of Moses and Elijah on the holy mountain hadn't convinced them about Jesus. In spite of the fact that prophecy stated quite clearly that the Messiah would be preceded by their reappearance, they were almost impervious to the truth. And as they moved on, their progress was blighted by arguments about who was the greatest. It was as if they expected to be swept into Jerusalem on a wave of popular acclaim, their leader enthroned as king of the new Israel. It's no accident that this part of the Gospel began with the healing of a blind man. As we move towards journey's end, a blind man again receives his sight and, full of joy, follows Jesus. We could, I suppose, simply take this as the activity of a wandering miracle worker. Jesus goes everywhere doing good and leaves behind him a collection of healthy and happy people. But no, he himself goes on to suffering and death. The truth he comes to proclaim isn't so much about health and well-being in this life, though both of those are desirable. It is about God, who in this man Jesus takes on human form and invites us all to follow him through suffering and death into the life that knows no end. So the story isn't merely about the healing of physical blindness. It tells of the healing of Christological blindness. What stops people recognizing Jesus for who he really is? The miracle is the realization of who this is and of the demands of discipleship. The others couldn't see this, but Bartimaeus was willing to follow simply because of who Jesus was, regardless of the consequences. So that's why Bartimaeus is given a name. The other two synoptic gospels don't name him. Mark does. And this may be because Bartimaeus belonged to an early Christian community, perhaps at Jericho, that first shaped the story. So really, the story is more about the nature of our discipleship than about the healing of a blind man. And as you look at it, you can point to things and connect them with the road along which we are invited. He may have been blind and a beggar, but this man had a genuine desire for the Messiah. He must have heard the prophecies. And the passage from Jeremiah celebrating the return of the Israelites from the exile in Babylon to the promised land. With them, the blind and the lame, women with child, women in labor, all together, a mighty throng will return here. But more than that, he must have known that that passage from Isaiah, where the sign of the coming of the Messiah was that the deaf will hear, the blind see, and the lame walk. He must have known too that the Messiah will be a descendant of David. Son of David, Jesus, have pity on me. A burning desire for this man, in whom he recognized the fulfillment of all the hopes of humanity and the warmth of God's own desire for his people. How cool our response to Jesus as he walks by. How indifferent we can be to the constant outpouring of his love, his abiding presence. That desire needs to be fanned into flame so that we want nothing more than to be with Christ. Would we be able to voice our desire for him? And if we did, would people scold us and tell us to keep quiet? Jesus endorses the recognition by calling Bartimaeus. The response is immediate and dramatic. Bartimaeus throws off his cloak and goes to Jesus. In fact, he leaves behind the only bit of security a man in his position would have. It would serve as a blanket at night, and during the day when he was begging, he would be sitting on it, but he left it. How much are we prepared to leave behind to follow Jesus? Are we able to see that this call is more important than anything else in our whole existence? And have we the faith to take the risk of responding? The reward of faith, your faith has saved you, is the restoration of his sight. And he already saw. His faith shot out as soon as he heard Jesus' approach. The healing is vindication, the battle for his commitment already won. How often do we make our discipleship conditional? How often do we try and bribe God with promises of loyalty? And how often is the miracle denied because our faith is so weak? Bartimaeus had faith from the start. The arrival of the one he desired meant that faith led him to take risks. And the ultimate risk was to follow Jesus ente hodo along the road. That was the biggest risk of all. For Jesus, it meant death. And death, too, for most of the people who would admit to being his friends. Perhaps Bartimaeus was martyred. Following Jesus, Jesus brings danger, but that was not an issue to the man who had been blind. He could now see who Jesus was, and nothing mattered to him more than being with him. In less fraught times, being a follower of Jesus brings less obvious dangers. But there are dangers, and they tend to be psychological rather than physical. We hone ourselves up to questioning and ridicule if we admit to belonging to the church, and our scale of priorities can set us against the people we love. The very giving up of our time for God, especially the duty of worship, really can present us with difficult choices. I'm not so bothered about the issues where Christians might take a stand. So much of that is a grey area these days. What matters is what we think of God, of how God is in relation to us, what God might require of us in the way we use our time, our skills, and our money. The revelation of the true nature of Christian discipleship comes not simply from our attitude to conservation or to human rights, worthy as these causes are. Christians are recognized by their closeness to the God of Jesus, and by their willingness to accept the risks of following someone who lived 2 millennia ago, who died as a criminal, and whose followers fled when he was arrested. The miracle for us is that this same Jesus still calls us. May our hearts burn with such desire for him that the miracle of recognition takes us on to new risks, and with Bartimaeus, we follow Jesus along the road. pray together to God our Father. We ask the Lord to increase our faith so that we may have the courage to walk with Bartimaeus along the road of Christian discipleship, following Christ our Saviour, whose love for us never fails. For the Christian community in this place, that it may be a sign of God's love. Pray too for Martin, our bishop. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the world which God so loves, for which Christ came, for which he gave his life and died out of love. Remember those who suffer in many ways through sickness, persecution, deprivation of any kind. We pray for those who govern, for wisdom in their task. For our own country, for Elizabeth, our Queen, and her government, and for all who take decisions that affect our lives. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For our families, friends, neighbours and colleagues, for all who live and work in this locality, for those who visit this city, for all in sickness or distress at this time, may they feel the support of our prayer and the healing power of God's love. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For those who have died, that they may find their fulfillment in God's eternal kingdom. For any who died recently, and for those whose anniversary of death falls at this time, rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
May the light of heaven shine upon them.
We join our prayers with those of our patrons of Paul and all the saints as we acclaim Mary, the ever virgin Mother of God.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our deaths.
In a moment of silence, let us bring our own prayers to the Father. Merciful Father,
accept this prayer for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
very bad place. But this sacrifice, which is both yours and mine, may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hand for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church.
Look, we pray, O Lord, on the offerings we make to your majesty, that whatever is done by us in your service may be directed of a walk your glory through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And the Lord also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right. Give him thanks and praise.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you so love the world that in sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you love in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we have lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim. Broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
And also with you.
Let us greet one another. the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say a word, and I shall be healed.
May your sacraments, O Lord, we pray, perfect in us what lies within them, that what we now celebrate in signs, we may one day possess in truth, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We'll be seated, please. Very warm welcome to any visitors here with us today, and an invitation to all to stay behind afterwards for some refreshments. Could I draw your attention to the notices on the inside of the Mass book today, particularly the concerts arranged by the Friends of St. Paul's on four Saturdays. Please support these if you possibly can. And next Sunday will be the Feast of All Saints, special day in the church's calendar when we celebrate all those we name as saints and who support us with their constant prayer. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Bless you in his kindness and pour out saving wisdom upon you.
Amen.
May he nourish you always with the teachings of the faith and make you persevere in holy deeds.
Amen.
May he turn your steps towards himself and show you the path of charity and peace.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go forth in peace.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
And she by the Holy Ghost.
beseech thee, O Lord, for thy grace in our hearts, that as we have known the incarnation of thy Son, Jesus Christ, by the message of an angel, so by his cross and passion we may be brought unto the glory of his resurrection. Through the same